And this is the point where we encourage some of the young people will choose. There's a pre-readers group downstairs. There's also a readers group for the elementary kids and the preschool kids. If you would like to be a part of that children's church, you can go as they're making their way downstairs. For the rest of us, I don't know if it's just media or people in general, which do they seem more eager to share? Good news or bad news? Usually it's bad news, especially if it's a tale of someone else's misery or mistake. And we were talking last Sunday morning in adult Sunday school class downstairs, there's that delicate balance with saying thank you or being appreciated. So nobody does good deeds solely so that somebody will say, hey, that's great, we appreciate it. But at the same time, that goes a long way. When somebody is grateful or appreciative, it helps you not become weary in doing good. And you don't ask for appreciation because if you get it then, you don't know if it's forced or fake. But at the other end of that spectrum, how often do you have to ask people to give you criticism or complaints? Well, not very. Those are free. Criticism usually comes your way pretty readily. Complaints have a habit of showing up even when you're not asking for them. Sometimes it seems like everybody's got a critique. Our disciple of record this month, Peter, this apostle that we're looking at, he understands everything about criticism. Okay, I think he gets his fair share and maybe a little more sometimes. How many Christians critique Peter? And I have been guilty. He blew it that time. Made this mistake over here. Put his foot in his mouth back there. There's one, John MacArthur refers to him as the man with the foot-shaped mouth. And now I want to, in even with that being true, what about the times, if they exist, when Peter chose wisely, did this very well-known, imperfect apostle ever make any good decisions? Was there anything that ever came his way that was not his fault? Because you hear that, it's not my fault. Hear that all the time. Those lovely words, not my fault. I'm not responsible. I didn't do it. But what if you're right? What sometimes we're honestly not to blame. Does trouble or struggle or difficulty ever come our way and it's not our fault? Or at least not totally our fault. Can you be trying hard and still get tripped up at the same time? Peter, I think that happens to Peter here in Matthew 14. If you want to turn in your New Testament, Matthew chapter 14, very famous incident with Jesus and Peter, this walking on the water episode. And it's so easy to condemn our man Peter. He failed. He sank. You of little faith, you were wrong. But I'm asking you this morning, as we read through this again, listen for any times or any ways where maybe perhaps Peter makes a good choice. Even in the midst of this very well-documented failure, it's page 820 in the Black English Standard Translation in the pews there, Matthew chapter 14, and the account picks up with verse 22. Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, which that starts at 3 a.m., so in the middle of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, don't be afraid. Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Come, he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. You of little faith, he said, why did you doubt? And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly you are the Son of God. Very famous account, very well-known failure. Peter almost drowned. But even in the midst of that, do you see these? You know, Peter did make some good decisions. One of those would be that Peter chose to follow Jesus' instructions. So if you had a plus and a minus, mark this one down in the plus column. Peter is only in this predicament because he agreed, he obeyed, and he got in a boat that Jesus told him to get into. This account follows right on the heels, if you have the whole text open, from the feeding of the 5,000, this miraculous event where Jesus takes that one little kid's lunch and feeds thousands of people. And it's a miraculous praise. It's a great victory. Everybody's excited. The disciples are apart. And the people thrilled to the degree that they kind of want to make Jesus king. And Jesus knows that these disciples, they're not going to be able to handle that kind of popularity or that power right now. So he sends them out. He stays with the crowd. He says, I'll stay here with the popular people, and you guys just go row someplace else. And I don't know. It's not evening yet. I don't know if the dark clouds are starting to roll in. I don't know if any of these veteran fishermen, they're looking at the sun, they're looking at the water. They said, you know, if it gets dark out there, it could be bad. But you don't hear any complaints from them. You don't hear any of them going, how come we have to leave? You know, this is just getting to be the good part. Everybody's liking us for a change. How come we have to go? Peter and all the guys, they do what they're instructed to do. And we read in this text where obedience takes them. 3.5 miles into a storm and 9 hours of the wind in your face. But it's always good to follow Jesus' instructions, even if you get rained on for a while. And we need to remember that Peter and the disciples here, because maybe sometimes we feel like Jesus is leading us in the wrong direction, or he's not listening to us. I read a book, James A. Howe, PhD, wrote The Apostle Peter, and he wrote it this way. How many times are we guilty of reducing God to being the genie in the lamp? Instead of having an open, ongoing devotion with God, we keep him locked away and then allow God to be released only to grant us what we need or want. Afterwards, we demand that God get right back in the lamp until another day. He's a counselor. He said, I have counseled many people who come to crisis moments in their faith simply because God did not live up to their expectations. For some people, God didn't answer their prayers according to their specifics. Or God's answer wasn't fast enough. They were convinced that God misunderstood their prayer request. God's answer or leading may not immediately bring me out of the storm, but it's still always a good decision to follow Jesus' instruction. You can ask Job, that guy in the Old Testament. There's a whole book named after him. He follows God. He's obedient to God, even in the midst of all the struggle and the trial. And in the end, he is greatly rewarded. Or the man born blind, we often look at him in John 9, and that story starts out because something's wrong, the blindness, and everybody thinks somebody sinned. And that's the first question. Well, whose fault? Who sinned? Him or his parents? And Jesus says, nobody sinned. That's not their fault. This happened so that the power of God can be displayed. And we usually stop right there, but the next verse, this is a guy where Jesus spits on the ground, makes mud, puts it on this blind guy's eyes, and then tells him, go wash in the pool. And I think that took great faith on that part of that man to literally walk away from Jesus, still blind, but to walk away and follow his instructions, which did lead later to him having his sight. And I believe that Peter learned these lessons of following Jesus, because we often look at what Peter wrote in his books. This is 1 Peter 1, 6, 7, 8, 9. This is him later in life. In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And that's Peter telling his first audience, and he's telling us today, you can be well within the will of God and still face a struggle and a battle and a storm. But God always has a reason for his leading. That's how you grow. That's how you mature through these battles. You always follow Jesus' instructions regardless. Put another one in the plus column for Peter. You got to admit, he did walk on water. He did. Okay, there's only two people in the history of mankind that have literally walked on water, Jesus and Peter. And we use this phrase now as an insult. You know, he thinks he walks on water. But Peter could honestly say, and we made that that substance in Vacation Bible School when we had this story. You mix cornstarch, just cornstarch and water, and you get the right consistency. And it's the term is oobleck. The scientific word is a non-Newtonian liquid. And it will hold up under kids or anybody's feet as long as you don't stop. You go through quickly, it'll support you. But if that kid stops, you sink. So Peter is the only other person other than Jesus who can honestly say, well, yeah, technically that one time I did. I walked on water before I sank. So say what you want about all his failings and his shortcomings, and we have and we will. But Peter had the faith, Peter had the courage to get out of the boat, and he walked out there where nobody else was willing to go. There wasn't any crowd out there in the water. And I read this, I don't know if you saw last July, Benjamin David, he lives in Munich, Germany, and he got tired of the traffic on the commute. So he traded his bicycle for a wetsuit, and David swims every morning 1.24 miles to work down the Iser River rather than fighting through the traffic on his bike. And the guy, he said, I'm not a monk. He said, when I was on my bike, I would yell at the cars. So then I started walking, then I started yelling at the bikes. And he said, and I looked over here just a few meters, this is a river. Nobody in it. And he said, when you're in the river, it's calm and peaceful and relaxed and refreshing. And he said, the current is fast. I have a little flotation device. If the current just takes him 25 minutes, he gets to work. If he needs to get there faster, he swims, he can make it in 15. Carries his clothes in that little waterproof bag. Unlike Peter in his event, Benjamin David does not expect to remain to be the only commuter who swims. He said that the river's going to get crowded. But he said it's going to take about 100 years for it to be as bad as it was on the road. And I have to wonder, how many times later in life does Peter, here he is, he's faced with some tough decision. He thinks, well, there was that one time I walked on water. I did. And Michael Card pointed out in his book, here again, it helps to keep in mind that this is actually the second instance of the disciples in distress at sea. They had an earlier storm. And Peter remembers the first angry storm and Jesus' rebuke. How is it that you have no faith? Mark 4, no faith. He says, he's determined to not hear those words again from Jesus. So he does do better. And somebody's going to nitpick that and say, yeah, he went from no faith to little faith. But that's a little progress. Right? Two steps forward, one step back. That's still one step forward. Maybe you say, well, I'm not completely where I want to be as a parent. I still yell sometimes, but at least I'm out of the boat. One step forward. Maybe you feel like I'm not exactly the Christian witness I want to be at work every day, all day, but last week's better than it was a year ago. I'm out of the boat. Maybe you and the missus aren't on the same page every single day, but at least we're reading the same book now. Out of the boat. Don't toss all the good decisions just to focus on the one failure. And even when he's sinking, even as Peter's literally going down in the water, he still reaches toward Jesus. That's a good decision. Okay, and you can argue that he brings this on himself. He still seeks Jesus' aid, even in his darkest hour. I don't know if in his head is growing up years, a little boy in the synagogue, if he had memorized Psalm 18, 16, I don't know if that popped into his head. Psalm 18, 16, 17 says, he reached down from on high and took hold of me. He drew me out of the deep waters. He rescued me from my powerful enemy, from my foes who were too strong for me. Jonah can relate. Jonah, who was told by God, I want you to go preach in Nineveh. Jonah says, nope, I'm going to get a boat and go the opposite direction. Storm comes up, he explains what the problem is, he's tossed overboard, and as he's going down in the depths, he's crying out to God, and God provides. Michael Card wrote this very eloquently, it always begins with a cry for help. It always begins that way. It ends when we find ourselves doing the unreal and impossible. When we discover that if we, even for a moment, have risen above the noise of the wind and the confusion of the waves, we find in the darkness a face. Capital F. We discover in the tumult a hand, and we worship him for it. And John Ortberg writes a little bit more nuts and bolts terminology. Only Peter knew that when he sank, Jesus would be there. And he was wholly adequate to save. You know, and I don't know, maybe you feel like not succeeding a whole lot at the moment. Maybe you feel like, oh, I didn't really walk on water at all. I just kind of fell out of the boat and flopped a little bit and then sank. Somebody's going to say, I didn't technically get out of the boat. I was pushed. But here I am drowning. It's always a good decision to reach for Jesus. I love the image. I think Chris Irwin shared it with me first. You can see this online all over the place now. This is from Peter's perspective. Now that may well be what it looked like. And that might be how you feel most days. But to reach for the Lord's hand is always a good decision. And I'm going to move forward. And I just wanted the record to show that Peter does make some good choices. Yes, he failed. But it's in the context of some success. And I think that relates to a good portion of most of our lives day to day. You know, as far as why he failed, why he nearly drowned, the main problem Peter encountered was reality. It's real. The wind and the waves are real. Peter looks around. He makes an honest assessment of what is going on around him. And that scares him. And that can happen to the best of us. You know, at no point is Peter dreaming up difficulties in the water. Okay? He's not speculating about sharks. You know, he's not contemplating cutting his foot on some sharp rock. No, but the white caps are real. And his wet robe is now whipping up around his legs. That's a reality. And I know Jesus is standing right there. I know this is not the first time nor the last time that Jesus has to tell Peter and these guys, don't be afraid. We just had that last week when Jesus meets Peter at the same sea and they're in the boat and they've been fishing all night and Jesus tells them to go out and let down the nets. They have this miraculous catch of all these fish and Peter immediately recognizes who this is and he drops to his knees and Jesus there says, don't be afraid. From now on, you'll catch men. Says, when he calmed the demonic storm, the earlier one on the sea, he said, why were you afraid? As he approached their boat, walking on the water, he called out, it is I. Don't be afraid. You know, when he's raised from the dead, the first thing he's going to tell the women when he sees him, don't be afraid. Brennan Manning wrote this, if you don't have to be afraid of God, you don't have to be afraid of anything. And I know that's true. I know every single one of those statements is true. But then the preschool class squirt you with water in the face. And that's a reality. They had this lesson a couple weeks ago. I went down after Sunday school, and the preschooler said, hey, sit in it. They had little chairs arranged like a boat. Sit in our boat. And they start giggling. You know? And they're telling the story, and then the wind comes up, and they got a floor fan. And they cranked it up. And then the wave started, and little dude with a squirt bottle just all over my face. And it's just a preschooler with a squirt bottle, but you're still doing this because you just don't care for a bunch of rain in your face. Well, that's just reality. The fact is, the flu bug is hitting families hard and fast these days. That's reality. The market is what they're calling correction mode right now, and some of our account balances are dropping. That is reality. I sent a report from Chris and Nisha Irwin, our missionaries in Spain. I hope you got that. And I asked Chris a question about his parents. And in our conversation, he talked about his parents. He said, did you hear about Ken Hara? Ken went to Bible college with Chris and I. We graduated together. Ken had a master's degree in Greek and preached for many years. Died suddenly Wednesday night when his van drove into the back of a semi on I-70 in Indiana. They don't know what happened. If he had a heart attack, fell asleep. But the semi was going normal speed. Just crushed right up behind it. Just 11 o'clock Wednesday night. Died at the scene. That is reality. Leave Cindy and three kids. Michael Card said, Jesus will never condemn Peter or us for looking at reality. What Peter smelled drifting out of the tomb of Lazarus was reality. The gravity that is sucking him back down toward the bottom of the sea is reality. Says, what I look at the world and I have reason to doubt, gravity, cancer, poverty, those are all real. But this is a lesson that Jesus wants Peter to learn out there on the water. Jesus is continually calling on Peter and calling on us, don't let the current reality remain your sole reality. Look beyond that to the new reality. You know, where walking on the water is also real. where feeding thousands of people from one little kid's sack lunch is real. Rising from the dead is real. The new reality, and the more I stay focused on Jesus, the more able I am to see his face. You know, I have to keep my focus on Jesus regardless. And this brought to mind for me the voice of truth. I tried to set up the first verse and the chorus of the song by Casting Crowns. We'll put it up here. And that's, maybe somebody back there, Jim or Stephen or somebody, if you could turn off the lights and we'll see if this will play for us on the voice of truth. Our technology's on its last week, so.
Oh, what I would do to have the kind of faith it takes to climb out of this boat and then onto the crashing waves, to step out of my comfort zone into the realm of the unknown where Jesus is and he's holding out his hand. But the waves are calling out my name and they laugh at me, reminding me of all the times I tried before and failed. The waves, they keep on telling me time and time again, boy, you never win. You never win. But the voice of truth tells me a different story.
Picture didn't show up there. We'll check it next week. But you can still hear the words. You know, it was cold. It was wet. It was dark. It was scary. And Jesus was still there in the midst of all that. And that's the lesson that Peter needed to hear and we need to hear over and over and over again. You got to look beyond the reality that you see to the new dimension of faith. I don't know if you ever feel like, I'm on an island for God. No one else cares. I'm tired of this. I noticed this picture. I have a picture of these little bloom that was down here by the basement doors. And I just noticed that guy. Everybody around him's dead and dying and weeds. And I was like, keep it up, little buddy. just hang in there and do your thing. And then I walked in like 2 or 3 days later and I see this. Somebody had trimmed all that up and cut out all the dead and pulled out all the weeds. And it was a brand new reality. It was the same blossom, same location, but a new perspective. And John MacArthur wrote 12 Ordinary Men. And he made the point we talked about last week that Peter's a new name, new reality. Not what the guy is today, but what Jesus sees that he's going to be in the future. And he told the story, you may know that Tommy Lasorda, a former manager of the LA Dodgers, had a young skinny pitcher in their farm system. And the youngster was somewhat timid, but he had a very powerful and accurate arm. And Lasorda was convinced that I think this guy has the potential to be one of the greatest ever. But Lasorda said, this kid needs to be a little more fierce. He needs to be a little bit more competitive. He needs to lose his timidity. So he gave him a nickname, which was exactly opposite of his personality, called this skinny kid Bulldog. And said, over the years, that's exactly what Earl Hershiser became. One of the most tenacious competitors that ever took the mound in the majors. The nickname became a perpetual reminder of what he ought to be. And before long, it shaped his whole attitude. And we'll say it again, and we'll acknowledge that Peter did fail. He doubted. He looked around. He took his eyes off Jesus. He sank in the waves. Be that as it may, he made some good, sound, courageous decisions. And he learned through this encounter to always look to Jesus, no matter what is going on, to see the reality of the risen Savior and his power. And if you and I, if we can learn to do that same thing in our day-to-day, that's a most helpful lesson, to be sure. Let's pray and we'll close. Heavenly Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to gather, to study, to pray, to sing, to give, to meet around the table. Father, thank you for the reality of the risen Lord who comes to us sometimes even walking on the water, the impossible in the midst of what surrounds. And we pray that we will be able to not only see his face and seek his hand, but we can be encouraged by those times and ways when we too have chosen wisely. We've made a good effort. We're making progress. Help us to see those even when our failures are so obvious and magnified. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
We would encourage you again at this point to consider your own relationship. Maybe this is the day and the time that you want to make that decision of faith. We invite you to come to the front. Let's stand together. We'll sing this hymn. The title is Without Him. Some folks are giving us cash to put in that box there on the table for Ragamuffin's gift cards, or maybe you have some from Cane's or Chipotle or Panera, whatever you put in that little green tin. But we just want to encourage the teachers this month, and I appreciate your willingness to help with that. I know there's a Bible study starting Tuesday at our house, gluten-free as far as the food, the snacks. It's not a whole meal, right?
Right.
So that'll be Tuesday at our house if you want to talk with Denise on that. Trying to think what else coming up. I know Jeff's on vacation. He'll be back Tuesday, but he has things prepared for this evening to be as normal for the kids, so you can come tonight for that. How about I'll just give you a couple moments again to just pray silently about those challenges in your life, and then we'll close. Heavenly Father, help us to see you through the wind and the waves. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Let's close this morning. We'll sing, I'll Fly Away.